Was dark as the dungeon where the sun seldom shine. Oh, I question, Lord, why must this be? And he told me there's joy in my sorrow. Victory in each trial for me. Oh, Jesus, lead me beside still waters. Somewhere in the valley was dark as the dungeon where the sun seldom shine. Oh, I question, Lord, why must this be? And he told me there's joy in my sorrow. Victory in the trial for me. Oh, Jesus, lead me beside still waters.
Good evening, everyone. It is truly a great pleasure to present to you this evening my favorite topic about God's love. And I've titled this God's Amazing Love. Yesterday, someone asked what was the theme running through, and there it was, love. And then I think it was mind, but to me, I heard God's love right throughout all the presentations that I would have been I would have heard. So God's amazing love is what we're going to look at this evening. And right, let me make sure I have everything here right. Okay, so just let's bow for a word of prayer before we get deep into what God's love is like. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for this opportunity where I can present the word, your word, on your amazing love, so that your name may be glorified. Father, thank you for who you are. I thank you for being you, that you would have condescended to die on the cross to show us that love. And as I present your word, Father, let me speak your words, not my words, and give us all receptive hearts and minds that we may be able to understand, and that your word may go deep into our beings, and that it might be a transforming power. So be with us, I pray, for Christ's sake, amen. Okay, so I'm not going to go into detail of, I want to look briefly, very briefly, at death. And I'm not going to go into a lot of detail because that in itself is a presentation. I will just give a synopsis of the death as understood when we look at a proper exegesis of the Bible. Now, Jesus spoke of a sleep. And we know that as Jesus did his ministry, he always spoke of a sleep. Lazarus, and also of Jairus' daughter. And John 11:11 says, "These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, Our friend Lazarus sleepeth. Christ said, He sleeps." And his disciples, the man is dead. And how be it that they're seeing that he's dead and Christ is saying he's asleep? And then after Christ said to them, "Okay then, if you say so, Lazarus is dead." There Jesus calls that a sleep. And that sleep death is one that we can come back from. And like as in a sleep, we can wake up from it and we can be resurrected also from it. And that is that sleep death. Now, we're going to look briefly at the second death. Revelation 26 reads, "Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power." So there's a sleep death and there's also a second death. And then that's also made clear in Psalms 37. We hear about this death that is an eternal death, and that is the second death. Now, Romans 6:23 states, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." The death referred to in these scriptures is not that pronounced upon Adam, for all mankind suffered the penalty of his transgression. It is the second death that is placed in contrast with the everlasting life. So here, So the Bible speaks about a second death, and it speaks about a sleep death. So if there's a second death, then we can, there is implied that there is a first death. So what is this first death? I want to share with you a story written by one of my favorite presenters, Ty Gibson. And his experience. Okay, thanks. Now, Ty is an Adventist pastor. So he gave this story. When he was a young Christian at the age of 19, he wasn't raised in church, and therefore everything had to make sense to him. He didn't just accept things that he heard. Now, one day he met a very intelligent man by the name of Russell who challenged his faith. And as Ty shared his newfound Christian faith with Russell, Russell stopped him in the middle and said, "Young man, out of all the religions in the world, why did you choose Christianity?" And he said it in a very condescending tone. So Ty was very happy for that question. I mean, he was just a young Christian. So you know how we are when we are young and new in Christianity. We are very, very exuberant. So Ty said, "You know, Christ suffered and died for me. He was beaten. He was spat upon, whipped, crowned with thorns, and then was crucified. It was terrible. He did that for me. That was a great sacrifice, and that is why I choose to serve him." And Ty felt so good about this response, and he leaned forward, and he thought that he would see tears in Russell's eyes. And now he was going to go in for the appeal. He thought he had a soul. Russell started to laugh. "Well, if all it took was a willingness to suffer physical pain for a few hours to become the savior, then I could be your savior and you could be mine." Ty was stunned. Sounds logical to him. Russell continues, "Who is to say that Peter didn't suffer just as much or more? He was crucified upside down. What about Paul? He had his head chopped off, and that must have hurt even for a while. What about the Christian martyrs that were burned at the stake? They suffered. So Jesus was crucified. Big deal. Men have died for their countries in wars, we know that. Mothers have died for their children. Many people have died for good causes. So since pain, since when does pain and death equates to saviorhood? Ty was stunned. This man must be an atheist. He has to be. But in fact, Russell was very religious and he was now getting worked up. He said, "Jesus gets so much credit for being crucified and I resent it." He then began to tell Ty about a man who he followed for 10 years on an enlightenment pilgrimage in India. And this is what he said about the man. He said he was a modern incarnation of deity. He was the embodiment of love and truth. And as he spoke about this man, Ty could feel the love he had for this man emanating from him. And he said, Russell said, "One day my master was captured by a rival guru who tied him to a stake, and they used a hot tongs and they started to pull the flesh off his body bit by bit. And they did his legs and they moved up. For prolonged hours, they just pull off the flesh. And then they moved to his midsection and finally tearing at his organs. And there were tears in Russell's eyes. And he said, finally, my master died in utter agony. As you can see, my master suffered a more terrible death than crucifixion. And yet my master is not seen as the savior of the world." So Ty couldn't respond because he'd never gone through either deaths. So he couldn't tell which one was the worst. And Russell truly believed that his master suffered greater and was therefore offended that so much was put on the crucifixion of Christ. And then Ty thought about it. You know what he said? You know, and when you listen to the sermons and so on about Christ's death, they always focus on the physical of Christ's death. Oh, he was tortured, you know, he was a crown of thorns, he was beaten, he was his physical death. What led to his physical death? And therefore, he didn't know how to respond. He just walked away with his religious legs, tail between his legs. And he didn't have any answer for Russell. But you know what? We have an answer for Russell. And we are going to explore that answer today. Why could not this Eastern guru, a man, or even an angel, die for us? Why did it have to be Jesus? So only one who was sinless and could come back from eternal death, only one who was as eternal as the law itself could redeem us and give us back eternal life. Christ died that first No, we're looking at the first death now. He died that first eternal death, that death which was ours. So unlike what we've always thought about Christ dying the second death, no, Christ did not die that second death. He died the first eternal death. And therefore, Russell's master couldn't die for us. He just couldn't be our savior. So I want to look briefly, just very briefly at, just compare the second death with the death of Christ, the death that Christ died. In the second death, there's total annihilation. There's no coming back. Christ was resurrected. The second death, as the Bible says, is a lake of fire. Christ did not go there. And in the second death, the complete separation from God. And that was experienced by Christ, but he was united, praise the Lord, with his Father. So that eternal death which Christ suffered was ours, and he died that death for us so that we may choose him and have eternal life. Hebrews 2:9 says that he tasted death for every man. And the difference about it is that he tasted that death while still alive. So those who reject Christ will die the second death. Christ died that first death, tasted it for us while he was still alive. So let's look at where it all began. Christ was standing in a different attitude from that which he's ever stood before. His suffering can best be described by the prophet Zechariah. He says, "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, and against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts." And I looked at other versions, and this one that I kind of like. It's not that one. Yeah. Now, as a substitute and surety for sinful man, Christ was suffering under divine justice. He saw what justice meant. Hitherto, he had been as an intercessor for others. Now, he longed to have an intercessor for himself. So, this is telling you what Christ is going through. But now, when I read this verse, I saw what the Father was going through, because the Father suffered as well. This is how the other versions describe Christ in that Zechariah. Rather than saying fellow, it says the man who's related to me, the man who is close to me, who's my friend, who cleaveth to me, who's my partner. And as I read those other terms used to describe the relationship, I saw a closeness between the Father and the Son. I saw that intimacy, and I saw how the Father had to let go his Son. He had to give up his Son to eternal death, and therefore too, it was pain for him. They had such a close relationship. If we look at Proverbs 8:30, it says, "I was beside," and this is Jesus speaking, "I was beside him as a master craftsman. I made him happy day after day." And the King James says, "Daily his delight. I rejoice in front of him all the time." So you can imagine that relationship where Christ was always the Father's joy. He made him happy. They made each other happy. He was in the bosom of the Father. So you can understand, you can see that love, that togetherness. And now they must be separated. So they were both paining over that separation. The Father has got to say, I have to let you go. You have got to die for men if they are to be saved. Do you see the agony that he's experiencing as well? I see it. So come with me and let's walk through the Garden of Gethsemane, where Christ started to die that eternal death. Christ in John 8:29 says, "He that sent me is with me." So the Father is with him. "The Father hath not left me alone," never left him alone. Always was there, and now he's undergoing that pain of separation. He says, "But now he seemed to be shut out from the light of God's sustaining presence. Now he was numbered with the transgressors. the guilt of fallen humanity he must bear. Upon him who knew no sin must be laid the iniquity of us all. So dreadful the sin appeared to him. So great is the weight of guilt which he must bear that he is tempted to fear it will shut him out forever from the Father's love. Feeling how terrible is the wrath of God against transgression, he exclaims, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful even unto death. And on Monday, I think Brother Ken spoke in Isaiah 53 where that soul death he was beginning to experience. Every step, and these quotes are taken from Deserved Ages, every step that he took was a labored effort. He groaned aloud as he suffering under the pressure of terrible burden. Twice his companions supported him or he would have fallen to the earth. He went a little distance from his disciples and he asked them to pray. He felt that by sin he was being separated from the Father. The gulf was so broad, it was so black, it was so deep that his spirit shuddered before it. And this agony he must not exert divine power to escape from. As man, he must suffer the consequences of our sins. And as Christ felt his unity broken up with the Father, he feared that in his human nature, he would be unable to endure the coming conflict with the powers of darkness. Satan was there too. And he saw the agony. He knew. Because he knew that should Christ overcome this, that the kingdoms would be the kingdoms of our Christ and our Lord, and he would lose. And therefore then he moved in for the kill. He had been preparing for this for 3 years. And everything for him was at stake. With the issues of the conflict before him, Christ's soul was filled with a dread of separation from God. And Satan told him that if he became the surety for a sinful world, the separation would be eternal. He would be identified with his kingdom and would never more be one with God. And then Satan used us like a dagger and he turned it into Christ. And this is what he told him. What was to begin by the sacrifice with the people who you claim to be above all others in temporal and spiritual advantages have rejected you. They are seeking to destroy you. And he turned that dagger. You are the foundation, the center, and the seal of promises made to them as a peculiar people. They want to destroy you. One of your own disciples who has listened to you, your instruction that has been among the foremost in church activities, will betray you. One of your most zealous followers will deny you. All will forsake you. And Christ's entire being abhorred this thought that those who he had undertaken to save, those whom he loved so much, should unite in the plots of Satan. And this pierced his soul. The conflict was terrible. The sins of men weighed heavily upon Christ, and the sense of God's wrath against sin was crushing out his life. So much so that the angel Gabriel had to come to minister to him because he was so low on life. And in his agony, he clings to the cold ground. I can just see him just holding on to the ground because he fears separation. And he thinks if he holds on that he wouldn't be pulled into that vortex of darkness. And he holds on, he clings to that ground. And then from his pale lips, he cries out, oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. He was all human. And his human heart longed for the sympathy of his long for sympathy, and his disciples, they were all sleeping. Whenever he came, he asked them to pray for him, pray that he can overcome, and they were all sleeping. Thus, when the Savior was in most need of their sympathy and prayers, they were found asleep. And again, he was seized with superhuman agony. And fainting and exhausted, he staggered back to the place of his former struggle. His suffering was even greater than before. and as the agony of soul. Notice we keep saying this soul coming, this soul. He was dying from the soul, not just his physical. His sweat was as it were great drops of blood. He said, "Oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done." The awful moment had come, the moment which was to decide the destiny of the world. The fate of humanity trembled in the balance. Christ might even now refuse to drink the cup apportioned to guilty man. It was not yet too late. He might say, "Let the transgressor receive the penalty of his sin, and I will go back to my Father." But you know what? With that amazing love, he said, "Oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it, thy will be done." The decision was made. He will save man at any cost. I'm getting those pimples. He will save man at any cost to himself. He will not turn from his mission. He will become the propitiation of a race that has will to sin. His prayer now breathes only submission. "If this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done." Praise the Lord. So because of this amazing love, he drank the bitter dregs of the cup. And that's in the garden. He's not dead yet. He's still suffering. He's still tasting death for us. 6 times he was tried before he was crucified. 6 being the number of man. He underwent that cruel physical abuse. We all know what it is. But as I read this, I said, Jesus, you're awesome. In the garden, when he found his disciples sleeping, he said he found an excuse for them. He said, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." And in John 19:23, I remember when the high priest Caiaphas was asking him about his disciples and his doctrine. And he said, "Well, there are people there who heard me. And they were there in the temple when I spoke. Ask them. Why are you asking me? Ask them. They were there. They know what I said." And one of the officers took his hand and struck Jesus on and struck him and said, "Answerest thou the high priest so?" And see the humility of Christ. Can you imagine? You're the majesty of high. He dared to strike the majesty on high. But here the majesty on high. What if I have spoken evil? Tell me, what's the evil I've spoken? But if I've spoken the truth, why are you hitting me? I just find that so humbling. That he could just speak to him like that. I would rant and rave. But he said, why you hate me? And again on the cross, he's awesome. Again on the cross, after all of that, you know what he said? "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And then the moment came for the final separation from the Father. And he cried out in agony, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And it was then that he died that first death for us. Where he experienced total separation from the Father as his life was crushed out by the weight of our guilt. And that's what he did for you, for me, and for every other man. That is the first eternal death. And that is why Russell's master cannot be the savior of mankind. He was a mere mortal, a mere man, a mere sinful man. Sister White says, "Jesus did not count heaven a place to be desired while we were lost. He left the heavenly courts for a life of reproach and insult, and a death of shame." Friends, I find that amazing love. Because of that amazing love, he went all the way to Calvary for us. And he did it while we were yet his enemies. But that is just a glimpse of the love of God. We don't really understand it. That's just a glimpse. So, why all of that? Jesus did all of that for us. And he wants us to love each other, just like how God loves us. Jesus said in John 17, 23 and 26, he says that the Father loves us as much as he loves him. And he prays that the love that the Father has, that love be in us. 1 John 4 alone. 1 John 4 alone has three times where he says, 1 John 4, 7, beloved, let us love one another. 11, beloved, if God so loves us, loved us, we ought also to love one another. And in 21, that he who loveth God love his brother also. So we have to love each other, brothers. But I want to ask this question. Do we truly love each other? Someone mentioned yesterday that in Malachi 3:16, one of my favorite verses, that those who fear the Lord speak often one to another. When we love each other, we talk. We relate. I can't say I love you and I have nothing to do with you. No, I love you. But you, no. When we love each other, we talk. Now, let's look at this assessment. It's one that Dr. Douglas had given us sometime, and I fell in love with it. And it's the 7 steps to agape love, 7 being the agape love. Now, the first step. Good morning, Roger. And I'm gone. I just greet you. That's it. The second step. Good morning, Linda. Nice day today, isn't it? And I'm gone. The third step. It's at the third step where we start to share opinions. And then once you have an opinion, have one, chances that we could differ and we might have a little conflict there. So that's where we start getting into the deep waters. So we share opinions. The fourth step, we share intimate information. You know, my children are giving me a little trouble. Nicola? Yeah. We've passed that, right? Yeah, we passed that. You passed 4, Nicola and I. We've passed 4. The fifth, now I share my mistakes. I've done something. I can come and share it with you. And I trust you. At the 6th steps, we're getting close. There's an intimacy. There's a loyalty. And at that 7th step, that step of final round in agape love, I'd rather be hurt than to hurt you. I'm prepared to lay down my life for you. John says in John 15:13, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So I ask the question, where are we on this ladder? At 1? At 2? At 5? We need to look at it. We need to do that self-assessment. Because God requires that we love each other. And love is so amazing that as you love and you express that love to a person, there's a feeling of joy and contentment. You know that? And when that love is expressed to you, then you can't explain that feeling. But love goes beyond just the words, right? There's an action. It's an action word. Because when I say I love you, then I behave that way. Christ did. So, when last did you say to your brother or sister in Christ, I love you? Roger, I love you. I love your spirit. I told Elvis that. I just love your spirit. I love you. Mm. And I want you to just turn, well, those of you who can, turn to the person next to you and tell them how much you love them and feel the love that comes from you to them and that comes from them to you. Just turn to that person next to you. And that's good. The love is, the hug is good. You touch. Well, I gotta go. I gotta go. I'm away from there. I love you.
I love you.
I love you. And we cannot make ourselves that unapproachable, because if we are sons and daughters of God, and we want to be, and we are in His image, we cannot make ourselves unapproachable. That's not God's spirit. You can't make it difficult for your brother or your sister to come to you and say anything to you. You just can't. But look to Christ. And as you behold Him, you'll become changed into His image of love. And He died that death. He died that death for us. And He wants us to love each other. Because you know what? He's coming for people who are in love with Him and in love with each other. Amen. So we're actually stopping Him if we keep this love and we bury it. But the beautiful thing about love, it cannot operate by itself. You can't be in a room by yourself and love. You have to have people. You have to share. You have to touch. You have to relate. And God is a relational God. Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And He has drawn us into that relationship. So, it is love. Amen. So, we want to feel the power of that love. So, as we speak about Him, as we reminisce of the great sacrifice, and as we behold Him, and as we study His word, may we have the experience of the men on the way to Emmaus, when they said, "Did not our hearts burn within us while He talked with us, by the way, and while He opened to us the scriptures?" Because as you talk about Jesus and His love, truly your heart burns. And according to my friend Ivor Myers, you have heartburn as you speak about God's love to each other. Thank you so much. Now we want to sing this song.